Welcome to Mind Under Matter. Tonight's question is this the end?
I got a fever, don't breathe on me. I'm a believer in nobody.
People say that we are living in a plague, that a pox is upon us. That's silly. COVID-19 isn't a plague, it isn't a pox. It is the zombie apocalypse. The plague is caused by a bacteria called Yersinia pestis. It is zoonotic, meaning it is carried by animals, most notoriously fleas and rats. It comes in two varieties, bubonic, or if left untreated, pneumonic, meaning it is moved into the lungs. Bubonic plague is, of course, what brought us the Black Death of the 14th century that wiped out between 75 and 200 million people across Europe, North Africa, and Asia. Now, what could have possibly stopped a devastating disease like that in a time where whipping yourself with leather straps studded with sharp pieces of metal to atone for your sins was considered a possible cure? Quarantine, so named for the 40 or 40 days that sailors were required to remain in isolation upon arriving to Italian ports. However, the plague lives on, and there are about 1,000 cases every year. Although, unfortunately, modern medicine like antibiotics and the introduction of basic human hygiene have really hobbled the plague's potential to save the planet. Fortunately, there are people out there that don't buy into that nonsense. Some really independent thinkers that will restore us to our greatness even if it kills them, or me, or you, or all of us. So this isn't a plague, but it must at least be a pox. Closer. Pox is caused by pox virus, such as variola virus, also known as smallpox. The most common form of smallpox is fatal in 30% of cases, meaning that you can catch up almost an entire supercontinent on the party that they missed out on a couple hundred years ago. Smallpox has been all but eradicated, and there hasn't been a natural outbreak of it since the 70s. Now, why would I specify natural? Of course, it's because the US and Russia and probably some other shady governments and maybe even some tremendous people living on a compound out in the Midwest with an arsenal of military-grade weapons all have samples. And Russia only spilled it that one time. And the US has a stockpile of vaccines anyway for if and when smallpox is reintroduced as a biological weapon because our herd immunity has expired. Vaccinations aren't just about you. So clearly we are not stricken by plague. There is not a pox upon us. So what is this? Is this just the end? I don't know, but I do know that this is the zombie apocalypse. Like a pox, COVID-19 is a virus, and you may have heard before that viruses aren't alive. They do not live, they do not die, although some people argue that they are alive in their own special way. Well, I don't understand why I've heard this discussion so many times, and I've never heard anybody come to the obvious conclusion, which is that viruses are undead. Viruses are a shell, literally. They are a protein shell containing a strip of RNA instructions, or really commands, for duplicating the virus. They just drift around until they bump into a cell, inject their RNA, and hijack the cell, forcing it to produce copies of the virus inside itself until it explodes and dies. And then those undead little zombie virus babies just drift around. They do not eat, they do not reproduce, they do not have any internal functions. They just drift until they bump into a cell, hijack it, and force it to pump out more little undead zombie virus babies. So what is a virus's version of a bullet to the head? How do you kill an undead thing? Basically the same deal. You shoot it through the head and degrade its RNA instructions. This is the mechanism for the virucidal efficacy of sodium hypochlorite, although obviously its toxicity to mammalian cells precludes its use as an intravenous virucide because, of course, no one should inject bleach. Although, of course, it's bad to make blanket statements. But zombies come in many forms in nature, including things that do actually eat your brain and control your mind. But I'm not going to talk about that in humans because even I'm not that morbid. Instead, I've linked a charity in the description that provides access to clean water. Please consider donating just $5 or $10 as part of your yearly holiday donation in honor of this most sacred night. So instead of talking about things that eat people's brains and control people's minds, I will instead talk about something that eats tiny ant brains and controls tiny ant minds. Ophiocordyceps unilateralis is the zombie ant fungus. It infects the ant, eats it alive from the inside out, and then takes over its mind, forcing it to find a precisely suitable spot for the fungus's proliferation, specifically 10 inches from the porous floor on the north side of a plant, and the ant clamps its jaws into the vein of the leaf, and dies. And a few days after the ant dies, the fungus shoots a stalk through the base of the ant's head, almost like a tiny flag. It is gruesome. But mind control can be more subtle and less literal than hijacking behavior. Neurons talk out their asses, or they talk through their tails. These extremely long, extremely thin, tail-like projections of the cell membrane are called axons, and each neuron only has one. When electricity travels all the way down to the end of the axon, called the axon terminal, calcium comes into the axon terminal from outside the cell, and the neuron's axon terminal releases neurotransmitters. This is the famed electrochemical transmission of the brain. This is how neurons talk to each other. And we all know that talking too much can get you killed. And that is how black widow venom does it. Black widow venom is a spicy concoction that includes alpha-levotrioxin. Remember that receptors are clumps of proteins embedded in the cell membrane of a neuron. When alpha-levotrioxin binds to a receptor, it causes more entrances for calcium, called calcium channels, to be added to the axon terminal. The additional calcium that these channels let in cause your neuron to release all of its neurotransmitters at once. Bang. And then your neurons start screaming. This is what causes the pain and swelling of a black widow bite. This is what kills their usual prey. They basically just talk themselves to death. However, this is rare in humans, and black widows are really very shy. They're more likely to run away or maybe fling a little bit of silk at you, and if anything, they might give you a dry bite, a warning bite that doesn't contain venom. So if you find one in your grapes, because their natural territory is grape country, just put them outside, let them alone to chat up the flies and mosquitoes and other creepy crawly pests that you don't want around anyway. So black widows won't bite. And if they do bite, there won't be venom in it. And if there is venom in it, it won't be enough to kill you. And if it is enough to kill you, well, if I bite that hard, you deserved it. I was trying to think of a clever, punny way to end this special Halloween edition of Mind Under Matter. And then I realized no matter what I say, this Halloween will haunt all of us forever. So if you want to make it out of this nightmare, be sure to vote, wear a mask, and remember, you never know what's behind it.
We cannot save you. We cannot save you.